Many thanks to Skip and Carol for that, and we are going to be doing that. That's many thanks. Is that? Oh, okay. I didn't know if you were giving me a sign for many thanks. We're going to be doing that actually every week, and I don't know. Did you kind of feel it too when the whole congregation was silent? That was really beautiful. He said, "Let's do it without words." It felt very powerful that we were praising God in a way without words, just from who we are. So, Carol, thank you, and Skip, thank you. I have a question for you today. I want just by a show of hands, if you've been a member of this church for 5 years or less, raise your hands. Okay? All right, how about 10 years? Raise your hands. 20 years? How about 30 years? How about 50 years? Okay. Question for you. What does the sign above the sanctuary door say? Don't, Hannah, I know you probably know it. And I know Amy. Is Amy here? Amy knows it. It's her favorite verse from Habakkuk, she told me. Does anybody know that verse that's above the doors in the sanctuary? Now, you've told me you've been coming in this church for 5, 10, 15, 20, 50 years. I'm going to start it. You join with me. The Lord is in His holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before Him. Habakkuk 2:20, Amy's favorite verse. That's kind of a joke because it's a book that we don't often go into. Now, the reason I mention that is to ask you how you came to worship today. I don't mean whether you came in, you know, a minivan or some other kind of car. What kind of expectations did you come with to worship today? Did you come expecting something? Did you come with a sense of awe of what's going to happen here today? See, that verse is very important. And actually, I think that verse, sometime we should put two verses on the doors. Not only the Lord is in His holy temple, all the earth keeps silence before Him, we should also have something like, shout to the Lord, all the earth, because there's a balance here. That verse always reminds me when I step in, and I always look at that verse before I come in for worship, is that we are entering into the presence of the Almighty God. Do we remember that, though? Do we get what's going on here? Do we realize that around us now, even though we can't see, are God's angels in worship with us? Now, you can believe that or not, but that's what the Bible says. Do we tend to think of worship as we're the kind of actors in the play and you're the audience? Or do you realize that God is the audience and you're the actors and we're sort of the stage directors? How do we approach God? Do we understand His holiness, His greatness? Last week in this series on the Lord's Prayer, we talked about our Father, and we talked about how important that is to be able to call God Father, the Aramaic word Abba, which is a very intimate term that a child would use for their father, their daddy. So we talked about God's closeness to us. Today we're going to talk about the next part in the Lord's Prayer, the first petition, about hallowed be thy name, God's awe, His holiness. And the premise is today, when we understand who God really is, it changes our lives. It changes everything about our lives. It puts everything in the proper perspective. We're going to look again at Matthew's verse, just like Carol is graciously going to share with us the sign language for the Lord's Prayer. We're going to be looking at the versions of the Lord's Prayer every week through the series, and then we're going to read a passage from Isaiah. Our first reading today is from Matthew 6, verses 9 through 13. Friends, hear the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." And then turning to the book of Isaiah, chapter 6. We hear these words of the Lord through the prophet Isaiah. He says, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted. The train of His robe filled the temple. Above Him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces. With two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory.' At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, we thank you for your living word. The word that we read, the word who became flesh and made his dwelling among us, Jesus Christ, your Son. And we pray now, Lord, that the words of my mouth and meditations of all our hearts would be pure and acceptable in your sight, our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. In Jesus' holy name, amen. August 4th, 1991 was a very special day for me. That was the day I was ordained as a Presbyterian minister. It's more than 21 years ago, but it's still a day I'll never, ever forget. You know, for starters, the little country church I was called to, the same church actually now being served by a former staff member named Cliff Haddix. Anybody remember Cliff? Cliff is pastoring the church I used to pastor. But this little country church I was called to serve was playing host to scads of dignitaries from the presbytery. Friends and family had come in from all over the country to celebrate with me. And even some of the young people with whom I'd worked as a youth director in Cleveland years before, even they were on hand for the occasion. So it was a great day in every regard. But one of the real highlights for me that day was having a man named George Dougherty preach my ordination sermon. Now, I know the name George Dougherty probably doesn't mean much or anything to probably most of you, and I think I've shared this with the men's study, but George was the man who followed Peter Marshall at the historic New York Avenue Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C., the church that Lincoln used to attend. Anybody remember Peter Marshall? That name is familiar. See, Peter Marshall, for those who don't know, was the famous Scottish pastor at New York Avenue for about 10 years, during which time he also served as the chaplain of the U.S. Senate. But after Marshall's unexpected death at the age of 47, New York Avenue decided to call George Dougherty, another Scotsman, to fill the pulpit. And over the next 26 years there, George Dougherty became somewhat of a national figure himself. For example, during his tenure, George welcomed presidents to the church. He marched with Martin Luther King Jr. in Selma. He became friends with Billy Graham and theologian Karl Barth. He hosted his own television show for 22 years. And he was named one of the most influential Presbyterian preachers in the entire United States. In fact, George was even the driving force behind getting the words "under God" included in our Pledge of Allegiance in 1954. That was him. And so when it came to the institutional church of the 50s, 60s, and 70s, Dr. George Dougherty was about as big as they came, and there he was. There he was, this distinguished octogenarian singing in the little country church that I was going to pastor. Well, I went over to introduce myself to him, more than a little nervous, of course. He was wearing a black robe and white tassels and a cape. An air of old-world Scottish dignity exuded from him. And one of the first things George did when we met, without nary an introduction, was to put his arm around my shoulder and ask me in a deep Scottish brogue, "My boy," trying to do my best Sean Connery here, he said, "My boy, what is the chief end of man?" Well, recognizing it as the first question of the Westminster Shorter Catechism, I immediately shot back the answer, "Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy him forever." That's what the Catechism says. And he looked at me, started nodding approvingly, apparently satisfied that this young pup could be entrusted with a congregation of his own. But you know what Dr. Dougherty didn't know, or anybody else that day, was that had he asked me the second question of the Westminster Catechism, or the third question, or any of the other 149 questions in the Catechism, I wouldn't have had a clue. He just happened to pick the single one I knew, but I wasn't telling him that. Still, you know, if there is one question I should have gotten, it was this one. Because glorifying God is the chief end of man, and it's also what this part of the Lord's Prayer is all about. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now, you know, when Jesus' disciples, and we talked about this first week in the series, when Jesus' disciples came and asked him to teach them to pray, he gave them very, very specific instructions. You know, he didn't just let them flounder around or tell them to make it up as they went along. Jesus gave them and us both an actual prayer we can pray, and he gave us also a pattern for prayer to guide us. So, for example, first thing Jesus teaches us, and we talked about it last week, is when we pray, we can call God Father, our Father. And that's no small thing. Because if you remember, no Jew before Jesus would ever directly address God that way in prayer. It just wasn't done. But we discovered, and again we talked about this last week, that when Jesus Christ is by nature the very Son of God, we become by grace sons and daughters of the living God through the atoning work on the cross. By an act of divine mercy, our status is literally changed from hopeless sinners to beloved children. For no other reason than that God is good and that God has a lot of love to share. But then, before we go any further in prayer, before we get into asking our Heavenly Father for things, or even before we start confessing our sins, both of which are important parts in this prayer, before anything else, Jesus tells us we need to begin with praise. Because praising God will frame everything from the way we talk with God to the way we live our lives. Let me explain what I mean. There was a man who went into an antique store once. The guy was a real expert. But as he walked around, he saw most of the inventory in this particular store was basically junk, definitely not worth his time. Well, he was about to leave when he spotted a cat drinking milk out of a saucer. When he took a closer look, he realized the saucer was actually a rare piece of china from the Ming Dynasty and was literally worth a fortune. Well, he thought to himself, man, this is my lucky day. This is the opportunity of a lifetime. Obviously, since this guy's feeding his cat out of this saucer, he must not know how much it's worth. So being a sly one, the guy said to the shopkeeper, say, that's a really striking cat you've got there. In fact, I'd like to buy that cat. Well, the shopkeeper answered, well, the cat's really not for sale. But I insist, the man replied, would you take $100 for him? Well, it's very generous, the shopkeeper said, shaking his head. I don't think the cat's worth $100, but if you want the cat that badly, you can have it. So the man paid for the cat, and then, as though he had just thought of it, he said, oh yes, by the way, I'll need something to feed him in. Tell you what, I'll give you another $5 for that little milk saucer on the floor. Oh, I could never do that, the shopkeeper replied. See, that's a piece of rare china from the Ming Dynasty. It's worth a fortune. But you know what's the strangest thing? Ever since I started putting milk in it, I've sold 17 cats. Well, you know, the point is, what's sacred needs to be treated as sacred, and what's holy needs to be treated as holy. And that's the intent behind this part of the Lord's Prayer. You see, to hallow something is to treat it with special reverence, to set it apart. And Jesus says the right way to start in prayer is by praising and honoring God. You see, when we begin focusing on the glory of God, not only does it honor who God is, but it puts everything else in our lives in the proper perspective too. You take what we read earlier in Isaiah 6, for example. In Isaiah 6, we find Isaiah's commissioning as a prophet in the 8th century BC. And as part of this commissioning, Isaiah has a vision. He's got a vision of God in which he sees God in all his heavenly splendor. Now, the really interesting thing about this vision is that Isaiah never really describes the Lord. If you noticed, when we read that passage, He offers no, let's say, physical description other than to say the Lord was seated on a throne high and lifted up, and that the train of his robe filled the temple. So he doesn't offer any specifics, but even here we still learn something. You see, even though Isaiah is light on the details, it's what he doesn't say about God that's so important. The fact is that God's so magnificent and so resplendent that no mere words can describe him. He's beyond description. I mean, even the train of God's robe, just the train, it completely fills the temple, which was simply the biggest and most magnificent building in all Jerusalem. So instead of trying to describe the indescribable, Isaiah settles for describing what's around God instead. He tells of seraphs, angels, flying around the throne of God, calling out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." The very words thunder and shake the ground Isaiah is standing on, and it fills the whole temple with smoke. In fact, the whole scene makes Isaiah weak in the knees. Why? Well, because he's caught a vision of the holiness and the power of God. And when he sees himself in comparison with God's greatness, he's suddenly struck with an overwhelming sense of his own inadequacy and sin. But be honest now. We don't often think of God like that, do we? We don't often consider the glory and the radiance and the power of God, or that the holiness of God is enough to melt him in a way, just like it did Isaiah. You know, that first congregation I served, where Cliff is now, I was visiting a church member who was in the hospital. She was been in the emergency room, and she was about to be taken somewhere else in the building for tests. But before they took her, I asked if I could offer a word of prayer, you know, standard. Well, the attending nurse looked at me impatiently and barked out, "Make it quick." I'll tell you, that kind of surprised me. I mean, you know, 4 years of college, seminary education, and several years in the pastorate had taught me that the emergency room is certainly not the place for a three-point sermon or a long, drawn-out prayer. Common sense dictates brevity. But make it quick? You know, my first thought was, who does she think she's talking to? Then it hit me. The real issue is, who does she think I'm talking to? The fact is, we've domesticated God. A quick little prayer at the hospital for good luck. A few words at a meeting to get things started. But that's not the God Isaiah describes. Isaiah describes a God of power, a God of glory and might. Isaiah describes a God of such brilliance and radiance and holiness that even the angels cover their faces in his presence. That's why Jesus teaches us to pray first and foremost, "Hallowed be your name." Because rediscovering God's holiness is the key for not only the way we pray, but also for the way we live our lives. You know, back in Pennsylvania, Faith taught at a private Christian school. And every day, the faculty would gather together for devotions and prayer before classes would start. And during their time together, teachers might lift up prayer for some of the students, or they might share a personal concern or a problem they were having. Whatever was on their hearts, they just got together to talk about God's word and pray. Well, Faith told me she really enjoyed these times of prayer together, but one of the most meaningful parts, she said, was the way one man, a man named Stan Miller, that he would always interject with the words, "But God, but God." You see, Stan liked reminding the faculty that no matter what they were going through or the challenges they were facing, that God was greater. And to demonstrate what he meant, he'd note somewhere in the Bible where the people of God were in an impossible situation, or maybe hope was lagging, something difficult, and Stan would share that passage and then note how the words, "but God," usually followed. And so, for example, in Genesis 50:20, Joseph says to his brothers, you know, the ones who had sold him into slavery, he said, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good." Psalm 49:15, talking about the destruction of the wicked and you know, their ultimate fate, the psalmist says, "But God will redeem my life from the grave." Speaking of Jesus in Acts 13:29, the scripture says, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb, but God raised him from the dead. And as Romans 5:8 says, but God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I don't know if you know this, but there are literally hundreds and hundreds of these but God verses in the Bible. Each one of them pointing to the power and the providence and the glory of God. One author puts it like this. He says, it's been said that the words, but God, form the most important phrase in the entire Bible. He says the phrase is used throughout Scripture as a turning point, a line of demarcation between peril and rescue, chaos and control, fall and redemption. Well, you know, the point is, this petition in the Lord's Prayer, hallowed be your name, it's about praise. It's about worship. It's about knowing the holy God as he really is. And when we know God as he really is, that knowledge begins to reshape and redirect our lives. You know, I like to think of it like this. Way back when I was in high school, to my kids it's the dark ages, but I saw a movie called My Bodyguard. Anybody see that movie or remember that movie? Anybody? Not a single person. Okay, it's actually a good movie. The story is about a kid named Clifford. Clifford moves to a new high school in Chicago, and he's harassed by a bully who starts extorting lunch money from him and from some of the other students. And every day at school is a nightmare for Clifford. He can't keep this bully off his back. It's torture. Till one day he gets an idea. Clifford approaches the school's outcast, a large, quiet kid named Ricky Linderman. And Ricky Linderman's got a checkered past. And Clifford goes up to Linderman and asks him to be his bodyguard. In fact, he even offers to pay him. At first, Linderman refuses, but the two strike up an unlikely friendship. And eventually, Linderman comes to Clifford's rescue when he's being beaten up. And from that point, Linderman effectively becomes Clifford's bodyguard, and the bullying instantly stops. Well, you know, as you watch the movie, it's amazing what having Ricky Linderman in his corner does for Clifford's confidence. You know, in fact, it changes him. He's relaxed and secure. He can go to school without any worries, and by movie's end, Clifford's even able to stand up for himself, all because he's got big, strong Ricky Linderman watching his back. Well, you know, in a way, this is what this part of the Lord's Prayer is really getting at. You see, when we hallow God's name, when we understand him for who he really is and have a vision of his greatness and praise him, well, it changes us. It reminds us, no matter what, we've got someone in our corner too, someone strong. Someone we can trust. Author Warren Wiersbe says this. He says, we know that times of true worship give us better perspectives on the matters that concern us. He says, the things that bother us don't seem quite as threatening when we quietly contemplate the greatness of God and worship him. That's why Jesus says, when you pray, start with praise. Start with remembering who God is and what he's done, even before you confess, even before you bring your requests. Start with praise. Let the glory of God frame everything else in your life and put it all in the proper perspective. As Tim Keller of Redeemer Presbyterian Church in New York City says, the adoration of God is what will heal your view of yourself and your view of the world. Just praising God for who he is. You know, the Sistine Chapel contains some of the most beautiful religious artwork ever produced. And a number of years ago, an extensive and somewhat controversial restoration project was begun with the intent of removing 500 years of soot and grime and dirt on the frescoes that adorn the chapel. Well, special cleansing techniques were used, and when the chapel was eventually reopened for public viewing, artists and, And historians, they gasped at the vibrancy of the colors that were revealed. In fact, some claim the restorers had gone too far. Now, whether or not that's true, I'm not an artist, that's up for debate. But what's clear is that centuries of grime, of soot, of black dirt, which had given Michelangelo's paintings a dark and kind of a brooding feel about them, they had given way to an explosion of colors that totally changed the way people viewed and interpreted the paintings. You know, it's like the difference between looking at a beautiful landscape in nature, between looking at it on a dark and cloudy day, or looking at that same landscape in the brilliant sunshine. The contrast is amazing. It was amazing in the chapel. In fact, it was such a surprise that it led one reporter to even remark that God has been seen in such a way that he had never been seen for many generations. Well, you know, on the cross, God was seen in a way that nobody had ever seen before either. In a way no one could ever imagine. You see, it's on the cross that the full picture of God's glory and love and even his greatness is displayed, because on the cross, both his justice and his mercy are perfectly fulfilled. Sin was atoned for, and grace was conferred in the very same act through the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we begin with praise, because God has done it all, and because God alone is worthy. And also because by remembering who God is and what he's done for us, everything else about us and our lives and the world around us is put into perspective. And then we fulfill the chief purpose for which we were created, which is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you for Jesus Christ, your Son. As your word says, the exact representation of your being, the radiance of the glory of God. Father God, we confess that we often, most times, don't know you as you really are. Lord, it's part of our condition as sinful people. Lord, it's also part of the way we live our lives, Lord. We're so caught up with things. We've always got our head bent down looking at a text message, Lord. We've always got our face in a computer. We rush from one place to another, Lord. We don't take the time, Lord, like your servant David, to just sit and look at the stars and say, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Father God, help us to see you as you really are, and whatever it takes, slow us down, Lord. Open our eyes. Help us take a break from technology. Lord, whatever it is, help us to recapture even a small glimpse of who you are. Because, Lord, when we know you as you are, we'll praise you as you deserve to be praised. When we see you, Lord, everything in our lives will be put in their proper perspective. And we'll know, Lord, as your word says, if God is for us, who can be against us? We thank you, Lord, for your salvation shown to us through Christ on the cross. We pray to be open to your Spirit now. In Jesus' holy name, amen.